Hi everyone. In this video, I want to talk about the last part of the Chatelier principle lab, which is to use the concept of coupled reaction we discussed in video 1 in the context of helping to dissolve an insoluble solid, which we discussed in video 2. In other words, this part of the lab brings together all the reactions you've done so far and combine them in one place. So the idea is we will start with an insoluble salt, in this case zinc hydroxide, which has a Ksp of 5 times 10 to the minus 17. Our goal is to increase its solubility, which means to make the precipitate of zinc hydroxide disappear completely or at least much less. Based on the solubility equilibrium, that means shifting the reaction to the right. How can we accomplish this? Well, you know from your experiment in part B that volume and temperature can accomplish this goal. But in this part, we don't want to use either of those tools. Instead, we want to do this using the concept of coupled reaction. So recall that this means you want to find reactions with K much larger than 1 that will use one of the products of the zinc hydroxide dissociation, which is either zinc or hydroxide ion. So what reaction will work here? Well, for the hydroxide ion, it's not too difficult. We already had a reaction from part A, which was the reaction between proton and hydroxide to form water. We can couple this reaction with zinc hydroxide dissociation, thus depleting the hydroxide and causing the zinc hydroxide to dissolve and dissociate some more to regain equilibrium. This will effectively dissolve all the solids. This means that we will need to add a reagent that can produce H+. Now, what about if we want to find a reaction that can be coupled to the zinc ion? Well, it's useful to remember that zinc is a transition metal ion. As a result, it can form complex ions if we add an appropriate ligand. So there are two possible ligands we can use in this case, either hydroxide or ammonia. The idea is that if we add these ligands, we will deplete the zinc ion because of the complex ion reaction. And because the zinc ion is depleted, this will force the solid to dissolve and dissociate to form more zinc ions to regain equilibrium. Now, later on, you will also be asked to test the same reagents, H+, hydroxide, and ammonia, on the insoluble salt magnesium hydroxide. And your goal is to make observations and see if these three reagents have the same effect on that precipitate. Okay, now let's wrap up this video series by discussing the experimental steps you need to do. Make sure you have your notes ready to write this information down so you have a practical guide for the experiment when you're in the lab. There are four parts to this lab. For part A, which is the acid-base equilibrium experiment, you need to do the following. 1. Get a sample of bromothymol blue and record its color as indicated here on your lab report. 2. Think about a reagent that will cause the color of this solution to change and add 1 to 2 drops of that reagent, mix it with a stirring rod, and see if the color changes. If it doesn't, add 1 or 2 drops more and then check again. Record the formula of this reagent in your lab report as indicated here. 3. Think about a reagent that can now switch the color back to its original color. Add 1 or 2 drops of this reagent, mix it, and see if the initial color of bromothymol blue shows up. If it does, then record the reagent's identity here. Now, if you don't remember how to cause these shifts in the concept of coupled reaction, go back and rewatch video 1 in this series. Okay, now for part B. First, you want to make a precipitate of lead chloride. You do this by getting some lead nitrate solution and then adding HCl 1 milliliter at a time until a precipitate is observed. Don't forget to mix while you're doing this, otherwise you won't see what you're supposed to see. Record your observation and volume of HCl you use in the first 2 rows of the part B report. Now you're ready to test the effect of temperature. You're going to heat the solution in a water bath and observe observe what happens. Then you're going to cool the solution down in an ice bath and observe what happens. Both of these observations will be recorded in rows 3 and 4 of your lab report. Lastly, you will test the effect of volume change. Add water until your solid disappears. Record the volume of the water you add, as well as the total volume of the solution at that point, in the last two rows of the report. Now note that the volumes that you record here will be critical later to calculate the KSP of lead chloride. Okay, now we get on to part C. So in this part, you must generate your complex ion solution first. To do this, use a scupula to get a very small amount of the cobalt nitrate crystals, which has this reddish color. Then, ask your instructor to add 12 molar HCl to the crystal in a large test tube. Record the color in the first row of part C of your lab report. Now you will test the effect of volume change. The way you do this is by adding water to the test tube 1 milliliter at a time. After each milliliter of water, mix with a stirring rod and note the color. When the color changes significantly, stop the addition of water and record the color right here. Note that the two colors that you will observe of these complex ion is either pink or blue. So what you have to record here is either pink or blue and no other color. If you see some kind of a different color, try to figure out whether the color is closer to pink or to blue. Next, you will test the effect of temperature change by heating and cooling that test tube containing the complex ion, and again recording the color that you observe in rows 3 and 4 of your lab report. Alright, last part of the lab is part D. In this case, you will start by making your zinc hydroxide solid in 3 test tubes. You do this by adding sodium hydroxide to zinc nitrate as described in your lab procedure. Now that you have 3 test tubes containing zinc hydroxide, what you're going to do is to test tube 1, you're going to add HCl 1 drop at a time, followed by mixing with the stirring rod and observing what happens to the precipitate. Your observation should indicate here whether there is more precipitate, less precipitate, or no change in precipitate. If you see some kind of a change, you want to keep adding the HCl until you don't see any more change occurring. Alright, once you do that, you are now going to repeat that same step with test tube 2 and test tube 3. Except that for test tube 2, you will add sodium hydroxide, and to test tube 3, you will add ammonia, which will be labeled as ammonium hydroxide on the reagent bottle. Last experiment is to repeat what you just did with zinc hydroxide to another precipitate, this time magnesium hydroxide. Again, make 3 tubes of the precipitate as you did earlier, and then observe what happens to each tube after addition of HCl, sodium hydroxide, and ammonia. Alright, let's discuss some safety concerns for this lab. The primary issue is that all reagents are at relatively high concentrations, so you will need your gloves at all times. In addition, when you're working with lead in part B, make sure you do not let the solution contact your skin. In part C, the instructor must be the one adding the 12 molar HCl into the test tube with the cobalt nitrate crystal. Lastly, all solutions today must be discarded in the waste container. Okay, so this ends the last video of the Le Chatelier lab. I hope you're able to write down all the information that I've given, and if you have any questions, we will discuss this when we meet in lab.